permission to participate of this very important event. I feel honored to be invited by this group, which I mostly admire. My congratulations to you. As it is already in the program, the title of my presentation is The Digital Metabolism of the Human. Can you hear me?
Is there a question? Which is the mic? Is the microphone working? Yeah.
Hello?
Much better.
Take a mic. By the mid of the 90s, when the commercial internet was just beginning to settle in Brazil, I was already convinced that digital networks were emerging with enough strength not only to last in time, but also to grow and multiply. Between 93 and 95, I stubbornly presented to the State of São Paulo Foundation for Research Support, FAPESP, three projects in sequence that aimed at the incorporation of the digital in the procedures of academic research. All three projects were refused by the foundation. God knows why. I have my ideas. All three, they were. I was not discouraged. And even without support, I began to direct my investigations into the digital field and its repercussions on human sociability and psyche. Since 92, I have published more than a dozen books on the most varied aspects of the digital universe, especially in the field of art, culture, and the making of science. Fortunately, the winds were blowing more strongly in my direction than in the conservative direction of that foundation. Just the one that should have its antenna attached to the determinations of the present in the direction of the future. That's why I usually say that history takes revenge, and it's poetry, the one that wins. Therefore, it's poetry that I have always taken as a guide to better understand the complexity of reality. More than a decade later, in 2008, a group of researchers from the University of California at Los Angeles, as a result of the Mellon seminars they organized, published the Digital Humanities Manifesto. In 2009, I inserted this manifesto as part of the studies developed in a course for PhDs on mobile networks at the Catholic University of São Paulo. Hence, this manifesto has become very familiar to me. Unfortunately, it's no longer possible to access this document in the web. But fortunately, I have a translation of it elaborated by Renata Lemos Moraes, so that the synthesis that I will present of this document below is a translation into English of the Portuguese translation that was made of it. So the Digital Humanities Manifesto. I'm going to present just a synthesis. The manifesto ran 20 paragraphs as follows. First, the digital humanities constitute a wide range of convergent practices that reject the sovereignty of written text as the exclusive means of producing and disseminating knowledge. Point two, it's necessary to glimpse an immediate future where the specific possibilities of the digital medium become the central issue. Three, the first web was quantitative, the second is qualitative, interpretive, experimental, even emotional, because it inserts in digital tools what represents the most fundamental force of the humanities, complexity. Four, interdisciplinarity, transdisciplinarity, multidisciplinarity are empty words. We should read that to CAPS. Empty words, unless they imply changes in language, practice, method, and results. Point five, the digital is the realm of the open. Open source, open resource, open doors. Anything that attempts to close this space should be recognized for what it is, the enemy. Six, yes, there is something utopian at the heart of the digital humanities. The open, the non-fixed, the contingent, the infinite, the expensive, the non-place. Seven, the practice of digital anarchy should be valued through creative disregard for copyright and the free use of multimedia. Eight, this is an abundance-based economy, not one based upon scarcity. It values the copy more highly than originals and restores to the word copy its original meaning of abundance. Nine, large-scale complexity, the need for teamwork as a new model of production and reproduction of human knowledge, taking risks, collaborating, experimenting. 10, co-creation is one of the founding features of the digital term in the human sciences because of the greater complexity. 11, incorporate entertainment as academic work. Talk with and to an audience. 12, the process is the new God, not the product anymore. Anything that stands as an obstacle in the way of free multimedia and remixing is an obstacle to the digital revolution. Point 13, the field of knowledge and expertise for it far exceeds the confines of the university walls. The challenge is to construct models of knowledge, creation, sharing that confront this increasingly distributed reality. 14, weaponomics is the new social, cultural, and economic reality. Social media produce culture. 15, digital humanities represent the integration and collaboration between domains of knowledge. 16, at the frontiers of entertainment, a new trans university audience for human knowledge is forged. 17, be aware of those who wave the banner of change by maintaining the continuity of their own agenda. 18, be aware of great reductionists. It's just a tool, it's just a file, it's just pedagogy. 19, digital humanities promote a flattening of the relationship between masters and disciples, redefine the roles of professor and student, expert and non-expert. 20, the digital humanities represent the practice of integrated research. a triangulation of artistic practice, criticism and commentary, inclusion, integration between academic research, education, practice and publication. Besides the 20 paragraphs, the document included additional 4 paragraphs with remarks on the finitude of disciplines. Instead of disciplines, they proposed a new departmental regime for the humanities. According to John London, the aim of these departments were Department of Print Media Studies to replace literature departments with the purpose of studying the materiality of texts, constructions of authorship, linguistic forms, the history of the book and book publication, antecedents to and dissidents of print, as well as the relationships and tensions between print culture and digital culture. Department of Discourse Analysis, whose purpose is to study the history of the triangulation of knowledge, discourse, power, paying particular attention to discursive structures, knowledge making, and the specific media forms in which knowledge is produced, disseminated, encountered, and valued. Department of Comparative Media Studies. The purpose of this department is to study sonic, visual, tactile, and immersive media through a comparative framework. This department replaces the division of humanities departments by media form. For instance, departments of art history, musicology, film, this atomic kind of structure. Department of digital cultural mapping, with the purpose of examining the junctions between space-time, information, and culture. It brings geographic analysis together with historical methods, visual analysis, and the presentation of knowledge. It also examines the cultural and social impact of digital mapping technologies and the significance of these mapping technologies for understanding cultural phenomena. The last one, Department of Cultural Analytics, which aims at bringing quantitative analysis from the math and sciences together with large-scale, complex social and cultural data sets. In the purpose of this Department of Cultural Analytics, I'm speaking about something that emerged in 2008. In the purpose of this Department of Cultural Analytics, the anticipation of the current big data explosion is impressive. In the years following the publication of this manifest, many blogs have come up to disseminate and comment on the new proposals of the humanities that were emerging as the result of the ongoing digital universe. Noteworthy is Lisa Spiro's blog, 2009. At present, she is the executive director of digital scholarship services at Rice University's Fondren Library. Written in 2009, her comments on the manifesto are acutely contemporary. I will limit myself to highlight the aspects of her analysis, which concern the problem of history and historical research. Based on a wide-ranging conversation among several scholars, she stresses the necessity of redefining digital history, which implies developing new methodological approaches, teaching both skills and an understanding of the significance of new media for history. coping with impermanence and fluidity, sustaining collaborations, expanding the audience for history, confronting institutional and cultural resistance to digital history, and much more. One of the most fascinating discussion threads was turned to the doubt whether digital history is a method, a field, or a medium. If digital history is a method, then all historians need to acquire basic knowledge of it. If it is a medium, then it offers a new form for historical thinking, one that supports networked collaboration. Digital history is not just about algorithmic analysis, but also about collaboration, networking, and using new media to explore historical ideas. Kathy Davidson, on her side, argues that the humanities, which offers strengths in historical perspective, interpretative skills, critical analysis, and narrative form, should be integral to the information age. She calls for humanists to acknowledge and engage with the transformational potential of technology for teaching, research, and writing. If we consider, let's come to the present. If we consider that these discussions and ideas emerged 9 years ago, we have to realize its anticipatory character. More than that, its anticipation of the needs for conceptual and methodological transformation that would become inescapable in the humanities field. This can be proved. The others go further, but the humanities, unfortunately, are always conservative. This can be proven when we, not the conservative. I mentioned the last part. This can be proven when we take into account the current conditions of the digital universe. A brief overview of these conditions of the digital, which I will present below very briefly, is enough to give us an account of the challenges facing the digital humanities today. We humans have always lived in hybrid environments, surrounded by natural and artificial objects. Nature and artifice are not two separate realms, nor are artificial objects mere instruments through which we conquer the natural world. From the beginning, since the invention of the fire, the inscriptions in the caves, etc., etc., we humans have been in and out of nature. This came in a crescendo, accelerated in the Industrial Revolution, with its machines already endowed with sensory intelligence, as is the photo camera. Then it reached its point of exponentiation with the cerebral machines. Intelligent machines, as are the computers, which expand human intelligence itself. They are not separated from us, as you see in the Hollywoodian films. They are parts, complements of our own intelligence. To get an idea, objects and environments transformed into communicating beings are knocking at our doors. When they enter that door, we must be prepared to conceive of them, to feel them, and to relate to them in a way quite different from the way they have always been treated in the past. Under the name of the Internet of Things, augmented reality, and portable, wearable, and implantable technologies, the tendencies that are coming are eloquent in this need. What's envisaged are global, immersive, invisible network computing environments built through the continuous proliferation of intelligent sensors, cameras, software, databases, and massive data centers into a world-class information fabric. When internet networks also involve things, as they are already beginning to do it, people will be using connection devices that will give them feedback on their activities, health, and fitness. This device will be able to monitor other people and a large number of tasks remotely. The sensors will warn us about everything, from things that need repairs to whether the garden has already been watered. Embedded devices and applications for smartphones or any other device that will replace them, for sure they will be replaced, will allow for the more efficient transport of cargo and goods and provide measurements of pollution levels. Intelligent systems can provide electricity and water more efficiently and alert us to infrastructure problems. Sorry about speaking those things in the Brazilian cultural environment of today. I'm sorry, but I have to. There will be real-time reading of pollution levels, soil moisture and resource extraction in fields, forests, oceans, and cities, which will allow for a more detailed monitoring of the problems. Experts say that all of this become routine readily by 2025. The current reality of connecting and communicating between people will expand to the objects, machines, and artifacts that surround us. These will be interacting intelligently, generating actions responsive to human behavior. All these upcoming tendencies will transform the gigantic communicative organism that already is today the web into a planetary superorganism extended throughout all the parts of the environment. In addition, groups of scientists and engineers working with evolutionary robotics are engaged in the development of robots capable, among other things, of dynamically identifying, analyzing, and interpreting the environment and learning from them in the manner of a living organism endowed with intelligence. It's the search for the development of subjective computation that aims at the emulation of some traces of the human subjectivity, such as adaptation and flexibility in unknown environments, reflexivity, perception, and human relations. Through algorithms capable of mental autonomous development, the research laboratories for this to become reality are numerous and are scattered throughout the world. It's not certainly the case here to announce a salvationist praise of the last shouts of technology. On the contrary, it's a matter of being aware of the new complexities of the human condition. At the present stage of intelligent technologies, especially of the genetic technologies, with the deciphering of the code of life and its consequent manipulation now placed in the human hands, and all the ethical problems that come from this. To understand such complexities is the first step in order to analyze the impacts that shape scientific and methodological certainties. In fact, the challenges are so obvious that many foundations of research support for the humanities were obliged to wake up from their sleep. This is what happened recently with FAPESP, which opened a call for e-science. The scope of is to stimulate the development of projects aimed at new research proposals, among others, those dealing with voluminous data and its treatment according to big data algorithms. It should be noted that the delay in opening projects of this order is also due to the lack of importance that the research foundations, not only in Brazil, everywhere, usually give to the humanities. They forget that we are facing now challenges, crucial challenges for our species. So, research on the humanities are of crucial importance. As Katz reminds us, much has to be done, and the common inattention to the humanities complicates the task. But the digital humanities have been here to stay, and they bear close watching. The digital humanities are today defined not only as research that incorporates computational technology into humanities studies, but also the one that uses the humanities to study digital technology and its influence on society and culture. The other way around, I would like to add to this definition a deeper and more crucial question, that without denying the importance of the transformation in the conception and methodology of research in the humanities, needs to take into account the pressing need for philosophical confrontation of the metamorphosis that the digital acceleration is provoking in the very ontology of the human. Thank you very much.